Thank you, Dr. Kirida, for an excellent, exhaustive, and fascinating insight into many aspects, particularly on this distribution of employment in sectors versus the GDP, what they account for in GDP. We might revisit that. Continuing on our lineup, I'd like to introduce Dr. Pavida Pananon, Associate Professor of International Business at the Thammasat Business School, who has done quite a lot of interesting research on the strength of Thai companies and particularly looking at their outward moves in recent years. So over to you, Dr. Pavida.
Good morning, everyone. For those of you who are regular attendees of this seminar of ISIS, these are probably unusual for many things, not to mention the gender of the panelists. But I know that ISIS is not always talking about the economy and the business. So this is, I think, one of the first few times that we discuss economy and business on this in this room and on this panel. So that's one thing that I think I have to thank the organizer for that. And I also think that another unusual thing for this panelist is that we all use PowerPoint, which is not very common practice in this seminar. So apologies for more PowerPoint, but because I know that I would be here on the panelist with three ladies from the World Bank, the Bank of Thailand, and the Thailand Development and Research Institute, I'm not going to bombard you with more graph and numbers because I know that I cannot outcompete them, and I can always refer to that graph when they mention any point. But I am sorry that I would bombard you with more letters and some more PowerPoint. But I think that what I plan to do in the next 20 minutes is to structure my talk into three parts. The first one is to address the kind of the common issues that we have already heard on the issues on the middle income trap, challenges for economic upgrading and all that. And the second part, I would like to also share with you some of the ideas on the global value chain. Why is it such an interesting issue that is attracting a lot of interest in the, not only in development economics, but also in business and in other areas that look at what firms are doing. And then the third part, I would like to answer the question set up by the moderator, which is what would be some kind of policy implication that result from this issue of global value chain. And I would also like to acknowledge the support of Asia Foundation that probe us to look into the issue of economic upgrading through the view of the value chain. And Veronique and Kim right there, thank you very much for the support for the research that we are currently doing on the economic upgrading of Thailand through the view of global value chain. So all that said, more PowerPoint, please. Sorry about that. Concerns on the Thai economy. I think Dr. Rung and Dr. Kirida has given you all sorts of graph and colorful graph. I could not compete with the team of the economists at the World Bank and the Central Bank of Thailand. But perhaps just to summarize what we have heard so far and from lots of newspaper report and everything. First, we hear that our GDP growth for the next foreseeable future is not going to be so prosperous as it has been. Thailand recorded double-digit growth in late 80s, but for now, we would have to make do with the range of 3 to 4%. And people might say that, well, 3 to 4% is not that bad. Not everyone can enjoy double-digit growth for a long period of time. But if you look at the average for the world economy, which is expected to be growing at about 4 to 5%, and you might think that, well, it's not too bad. But when you look at what Asia is expected to grow, Asia is expected to grow within the range of 7%, 6 to 7%, led by China. And within that region that Asia is growing, Thailand is going to be the slowest performer in this region, and we would be not exceeding 3 to 4% for the next foreseeable future, at least until the year 2017. So that's something that we have heard a lot in the news. And when we hear that the GDP growth of Thailand is not so impressive, people tend to think that, well, maybe it's politics. You know, we've had a decade of the political conflicts that makes everyone kind of hesitant when they look at Thailand. But then I think only recently that we start to hear more, at least today from Dr. Rung, that perhaps it's not just politics, but it also has to do with the structural issues of Thai economy that has not been addressed for a long time. And I think the politics doesn't help. After 10 years of conflicts, we probably have not had a long period of time where government can actually sit down and think about what Thailand and Thai economy would be in the next decade or so. So that's one thing that we probably have heard a lot in the news. Second, we also hear on the losing competitiveness of Thai export. And I think that I would borrow from the point and the graph that was mentioned by Dr. Rung and Dr. Girida. One great example is the electronics. We all hear that electronics has been one of the star performers for Thai export. But if you look at the graph that she showed earlier, you can see that other countries actually recorded higher growth in electronic export, whereas Thailand actually fell. I still remember it was in March this year when the headline in the newspaper was that Thai export declined again for the fourth consecutive quarters. And on the same day, and right next to the same, in the same newspaper, there was a news in the Bangkok Post saying that Singapore recorded highest growth in electronic export for the past few years. And that two pieces of news brought us to ask questions why in the same industry, two countries within the same region, pretty much doing the same thing, that is focusing on electronics. How come the evidence are so different? So we hear a lot of complaint on export competitiveness, not doing so good because the Thai currency is too strong. People complain about the currency, or some people might say that, well, everyone else is not doing so well, and Thailand export to the global economy, and when everyone else is not doing so well, that's why our export is not doing well. But I think the question also have to be looked at more seriously at the structural competitiveness of Thai export and whether more need to be done. So that's the second group of the symptom that we have heard this morning. And then another group of challenges that we have heard a lot is on the rising competition for inward foreign direct investment. Everyone now try to attract inward foreign direct investment into their countries. ASEAN is one of the regions that attracts the most inward FDI following China. But then we are saying that, well, now people are looking at Vietnam, people are looking at Myanmar. Thailand used to be the destination for flights, but now Bangkok is the transit point for other cities in the area. So these are another concern that the Thai economy, we have heard a lot in the newspaper. Perhaps some people might say that we are too pessimistic looking at these things in the negative side, and there are also bright things going on. But I tend to be pessimistic, which is not good. I try to be more optimistic about Thailand. But so let's look at why we are in where we are. And now you probably have heard a lot on the middle income trap. And this is a new sort of trendy word in addition to global value chain. So I think this panel put everything trendy together, you know, MIT, middle income trap, global value chain, economic upgrading. It sounds really sexy, all that, the name. I call this the bad MIT. The good MIT is Massachusetts Institute of Technology, so that's a good MIT. This is a bad MIT, middle income trap. And when we look at the middle income trap, and when you really look at the literature, the academic literature on middle income trap, and try to understand what they are talking about when they talk about middle income trap, you can more or less summarize the literature into two main groups. The first one, and one of the limit of the literature on middle income trap, is that no one agrees what it means. No one actually knows what they are talking about. No one agrees on the common definition of what middle income trap is. So when you read the literature, most of the literature tends to focus on the symptoms of middle income trap. What are some of the challenges that middle income country face when they are trying to upgrade to the next level? So one area of literature look at why countries are unable to transition from middle to high income in a certain period of time. And mainly they look at the lack or the weakness of technological accumulation, which follows some serious issue like education that Dr. Girida just pointed out. And if you look more in the literature, what people mean when they talk about middle income trap, and that's one thing, is that would countries be able to transition from lower middle income to higher middle income, and how long it takes for those countries to transition. And there have been studies that specify the number of years that countries should not spend more than 28 years in the bracket of lower middle income, and then they should be able to move into higher middle income within 28 years. I think Thailand just escaped because we spent 27 years. So we are one of those survivors who have moved from the lower middle income, and now we are in the higher middle income. And they say that we should not take more than 14 years to graduate from the middle income to high income. So let's see how long it would take us from now to reach the high income bracket. So that's one group of the literature that look at what middle income means. And then the second characteristic of middle income trap that a lot of people talk about is when countries are squeezed between low wage and lower productivity countries, and those with higher cost but more knowledge intensive. And I think Dr. Girida has helped me highlight this point by her graph on the wage rise and productivity rise. And you can see that Thailand is not doing too well in terms of productivity. You see, I kind of foresee that they would have graph on everything, and I can just listen to them and try to see which graph that they mentioned that can support my point. And please think back at Dr. Girida's PowerPoint on the wage and productivity, and then you can see my point on why countries like Thailand are squeezed between those lower wage countries like Vietnam, Cambodia, or Myanmar, and then we are trying to compete with Singapore on the other hand, that Singapore is capturing the higher end of value chain product and all that. So what have been the contributing factors that most people address when we talk about middle income trap? I call this the usual suspects. You know, we all heard this morning. Government institution, weak institution, and no lack of transparency. And I would like to draw you to remembering the PowerPoint of Dr. Rung from the competitiveness of Thailand. If you remember that point, she mentioned that we are okay on the market size, but we're not doing too well on the transparency and on the strength of the institution. So please think back at her PowerPoint for that first point on the weakness of government and institution. Infrastructure has been another issue that we discussed, that we need better infrastructure, both for hardware, software, and all that. Education was a point that Dr. Girida already stressed. Socioeconomic factors such as aging population, they have graphed to demonstrate that point. Macroeconomic factors such as the competitiveness of the currency and all that. So people have looked at these issues, which I call the usual suspect, when they try to explain why Thailand has been caught in this middle income trap. But I think that the view on the Thailand's economic upgrading lacks two important things. First, they lack the perspective that economies is not an isolated island. All economies are integrated by activities that are not only conducted by governments, but economic activities are also conducted by firms and by companies. And I think when we look at the literature on the middle income trap and economic upgrading, we tend not to look at two key things. First, what firms do. And second, what firms do here and what firms do outside of Thailand. And these are two things that I think why right now the issues on economic global value chain has received a lot more interest these days. And if you look at the key macroeconomic trends that is happening in the world, you would probably see also why we are hearing more and more on the issues on supply chain, value chain, and integration of activities. First, what we are seeing in the world today is that production activities are increasingly fragmented in something that we call global production networks or global value chains. What does that mean? It means that your iPhone is not only made or designed in California, as is mentioned in the back, but it's some parts of it is produced in China, some in Taiwan, and the design comes from Silicon Valley. But when you look at the integration of all these activities, and then you try to think who capture the most values, and it tend not to be those who produce or who manufacture, but it's those who capture the most value are those that are more operating in the higher value area of the production chain. But what is important for us in terms of Thailand as an economy that has received a lot of inward foreign direct investment is that we have been the country that have already taken part in this global value chain by being suppliers and exporters to a lot of industries that are important in global value chains. Industries that are representative of global value chains are industries that we have long been familiar with, for example, textile industries, food industry, agribusiness industry, or electronics and car are probably the most integrated globally in the current situation. So when you see this kind of industries, it means that there are firms that are active in this, and they are able to distribute their production facilities across the globe. And when that happens, the important things that come with those activities is that the idea of trade is shifting somewhat from trade in goods to trade in activities. We are not so much focusing on what we sell, but we should be looking more at what we do. So rather than thinking that we are selling electronic components, we should also be thinking of what we are doing in the value chain of the electronic industry. Are we simply manufacturing, assembling the most cheapest product and not really adding value? So I think the idea, and there is some kind of idea shift and paradigm shift in the development economics that try to look at activities in the world, not simply as a trade in goods. We're not simply selling electronics, but we are selling activities. So for Thailand to position itself in this kind of paradigm, we have to think of ourselves as, what can Thailand provide for firms that come to Thailand? What kind of activity that we should be looking at? Not just, okay, Thailand is a place where inward foreign direct investors should come in and look at Thailand as a whole. So I think what I'm saying here is that the ideas on the activities and what firms do is becoming more important because of the integration of production activities that is going on in the world. And also another important trend is that the value of anything that we do or we buy or we purchase is moving from the tangible to the more intangible, that is derived from knowledge intensive activities. If you look at studies of how the value of your iPhone, which costs about $200, the company that manufacture and assemble all the parts of the iPhone would capture about 12% of that value, whereas the most value, more than 50%, is captured by Apple, the company. So with that idea, it reinforced the need to look more into what activities we are actually doing in the global value chain. And for those of you who might not be so familiar with what this global value chain means, it's, you know, basically is the fragmentation of production process and the international dispersion of tasks and activities within them. So this is the capture the idea of global value chain. And why is it important? Because it involves a lot of players in this. It involves multinational enterprise that owns brand names, that own technology, but it also involves network of affiliates and suppliers and contractual partners, which normally come from emerging markets and developing countries, whereas the multinational lead firm tends to come from advanced country. And the power within the value chain is depends on the relationship between multinational firm and supplier as well. And why is global value chain also attract a lot of interest this day in the policy debate is because it's not only address the international trade, but it also address international trade and investment. Because when firms go somewhere, it goes to invest, and that comes with it foreign direct investment. So just to capture a little bit on the value chain positioning, why we should spend our time looking at more value-added activities is that if you look at the what I just described as value chain, fragmentation of the value chain, you can see, sorry, I have to point up, but oops, no pointer, that's okay. Most countries can be involved in the value chain in various activities. Most countries, especially developing ones, are engaged in value chain first as manufacturing. Think of Thailand. Think of Thailand receiving foreign direct investment in automotive, in canned food, in electronics. We manufacture. But is that the only activities that is in the value chain? No. What we should be looking at more is to move more toward the upstream and the downstream of the value chain, where value is more created. If you look at the downstream, this can be created more from market knowledge, marketing knowledge, brand name. Think of the firm. Think of Apple. If you just manufacture a part and if you don't have the brand name Apple, you would not be able to sell it at the same price that Apple sells. So for those who own brand, this is the kind of value that they capture. And on the upstream end is the R&D knowledge. If you own the technology, if you have the knowledge, that's where your value can be created. Whereas in the middle of the value chain, the manufacturing, that's the least value created and captured. So when countries are involved in value chain upgrading, I think we have to think along this line of where we position ourselves. And I think for most developing countries, Thailand included, we're still pretty much stuck in the middle of this value chain. So what we need to do more is to perhaps focus on the upgrading product and process. Upgrading allows manufacturer to be better. For example, Thailand can meet the international standard, ISO this and that, and then be better, to produce better, to sell better product. But we need also to look into how we can move to be more active in the upstream and the downstream activities. This is just an example, and I'm sorry that the letters are very small. You might not see it clearly, but I'm just going to tell you what this graph say. This is the automobile supply chain, and the you can probably have heard that we are divided into tier 1, tier 2, and tier 3. And the activities that are most value added is undertaken by tier 1 players. And tier 3 or tier 2 tend to be, you know, more general, not specialized activities, for example, raw material, whereas the first tier would produce more specific items, the engine or the computer or something that is more value added. And let's look where Thailand stands, where we are in this play of the automotive industry, which is a big industry for Thailand. You can see that most of the suppliers in Thailand are pretty much restricted at the tier 2 and tier 3 suppliers. Those who are in tier 1 are mainly foreign joint venture, and that means these are subsidiaries of multinational enterprise. And perhaps the tier 1, you might have some Thai-owned companies, but most of them are still owned by foreign companies. So they are subsidiaries of multinational companies. Is that bad? No, it's not bad, but we have to think also of what Thai firms are doing. If most of Thai firms are still doing the low rung of the activities, then we will not be able to push Thailand to engage more in the value-added activities, even in basic manufacturing. So when we, Dr. Rung and Dr. Kirida said that we should be looking more at that service, I agree with that entirely. But services is not everything that Thailand is engaged in. So when we look at all the activities that Thailand is involved, I think we have to look into the kind of activities that we are engaged in, not just manufacturing and low bottom end, but also the higher activities, value-added activities. So that draws to my third part, and I will finish within the next 5 minutes. Policy implication. What would be some kind of new ideas or policy implication that we could think of when it comes to value chain upgrading? First, I think Thailand needs to be thinking more in terms of a holistic and integrative policy that looks at the international economic activities that are all related to each other. For example, we are looking at inward foreign direct investment as a separate policy. We want to attract more inward investment, but we are not thinking much of what we are offering foreign multinational companies. Thailand can offer. We have been offering low labor costs, but now we have to also think, if firms look for location that they want to manufacture, they probably will be looking elsewhere. But if they want to look for a location that could offer them more value, what can Thailand offer? Thailand could be a place where they can locate their logistics center for the region, or Thailand could be some place that offer higher value activities to attract foreign multinational enterprise. And this doesn't come from just attracting inward foreign direct investment only. It has to also look at the industrial development of Thailand and the productivity of Thai labor that was already mentioned by Dr. Kirida. And second, I think we now have to start looking more at activities and not just industries. And we need to have more firm level understandings of what firms are doing, what kind of value added that firms are engaged in. If the government simply thinks that the only way to move up the value chain is to attract sexy industry like the digital economy and all that, what we are doing is just simply providing 4G, 3G and all that. But what the Thai economy is actually more layered than that. And we still operate in sectors that are traditional, like agriculture. I still remember that, you know, when I was growing up, I still have to memorize that Thai export is rice, rubber, and all those things. Today, the students, my students, and or even my daughter still recite that we export rice. But we are exporting the same rice, and we're not doing that much better in terms of the agriculture and agribusiness. So I think what we should be doing now is to look more of what kind of higher value added activities that Thailand is engaged in. We will not be able to get rid of agriculture or agribusiness ever, because it's the key industries. But what we should be looking at is how do we add value to those activities. Those would be something that I think has not triggered so much in the Thai policy debate. And I think the third point is building the domestic productive capacity. How do we make sure that our workforce is capable of handling more productivity and more productive activities? But at the same time, I think we also have to look at Thai firms, what Thai firms are doing. If we are still looking at Thai firms as SME who are not able to compete, and then government have to come up with policy to help them, then it will be like this for a long time. So what we need to do more is how to encourage firms, labor force, as well as policy to really increase productive activity. And with all that, I would like to say that I think for policy debate on economic upgrading, we need to perhaps shift the paradigm a little bit beyond what we have focused on the macroeconomic issues, and start to look more at the activities and the details of what countries and firms and people are doing in the interconnection of all this global connection that we now call global value chain. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Dr. Pavidi. You've raised some very relevant points that we might come back to. And before I introduce our last speaker, I'd just like to say, after Dr. Dunden, we'll move to some questions. So please keep that in mind. We'll take a series of questions, and then I might put it to our panelists for a brief thought at the end, a couple of minutes each, on what your key policy prescriptions might be if you were, you know, boiling it down to absolutely the top priority policy prescriptions. With that, we'll turn to, last but very not least, Dr. Dunden Nikomborirak, of the Research Director of the Economic Governance Thailand Development Research Institute. Over to you, Dr. Dunden. Thank you.
Okay, today I was tasked as providing looking forward of how Thailand can get out of the middle income trap. And this is something that TDRI has already studied, and we already presented in our annual conference late last year. So I will be covering three issues. First, I want to project the picture of where Thailand would be in the next three decades. Okay, under three different scenarios. Okay, one is that we do nothing, and then the second and the third is we do something. But what different? What do we do? Okay, and where will we end up? Where will we end up? And second, we will look at Thailand's current development models, and what are the shortcomings of our current development models. And the third is provide you details about the three scenarios of our development and what the government has to do in order to attain the goals of different scenarios. Let me begin first with the long-term prospects of Thailand. Okay. Currently, we are considered a middle-high income country, as Dr. Pavida said, and we were given that status since 2011. So 4 years ago, Thailand was upgraded from a low middle income to upper middle income country. So Dr. Pravida said 14 years, so we have 10 more years, right, to get out. Okay, and I will tell you whether we can get out in 10 years. Our annual growth rate has been 4.3%. Our economic structure, as already elaborated my former speaker, that agricultural contribute about 12%, service about half of our GDP, and manufacturing about 38%. our employment structure, Dr. Prabita has already mentioned that half of the employment is in services industry, 35% in agriculture, and approximately 16% in manufacture. Employees in our labor force, about 40%. Gini coefficient, which tells us how to the extent of our inequality of our income, is about 0.39. That is quite high, okay, but not as high as in Malaysia. I think Malaysia is 0.41, but certainly higher than most other countries. Our GDP emission is 1,109. Okay, so these are the indicators that I will measure in the next 3 years. So environment, income, inequality. So these are the factors that we will project forward. So what is the imperative? I think the biggest problem of Thailand is that we will become old before we become rich. Okay, Japan is old, but they're already rich. Singapore is becoming old very fast, but they're already rich. Thailand is becoming old very fast, but we are still poor. So this is our biggest imperative. How do we become rich before we become old? So what is the definition of becoming old? As you know, there is various definition by the UN, but basically is that if more than 20% of your population is aged over 65, is considered an aged society. Okay, so Thailand will become an aged society within the next 10 years. So the same year that we're supposed to graduate is the same year we become very old. So we better have, we have 10 years, you know, to get there, to become rich before we become old. And this is because Thailand has one of the lowest fertility rate in Asia, in ASEAN even, and probably in the world too, at 1.4, which is as low as Singapore, and a bit higher than Japan, 1.3, and Korea. So Thailand is going through the age society extremely fast because of our very low fertility rate, so we have very little time. So what does it mean to become an age society? Well, it means many things. First is that your labor force will be very limited. The number of workers that can generate income will decline. Population will decline to 33.8 million, prompting a severe shortage of labor. This will impose fiscal constraints, so we will have less money to spend in terms of solving inequality problem and welfare. So this is our serious concern. In the year 2045, 36% of our population will be elderly people. So this is the imperative. So what is the development model that Thailand has used so far to generate growth in the past? Basically three things. It's industrialized without technological improvement, and this has been mentioned by Dr. Pavita and other speakers before me, is that we import all our technology. As you know, we are export-driven economy, and most companies that export are multinational companies that do their R&D elsewhere, be it the Japanese automobiles or electronics. We exploit low labor cost, and we focus on exports. So these has been our development models in the past, that we exploit low labor costs or cheap labor. We also relied a lot on natural resources, okay, but it's time that this kind of development model is running out of steam as it's coming to a dead end. We've been able to generate growth with this model, but it cannot go on forever. As you know, that cheap labor is abundant elsewhere in many countries, African countries, the entire continent can come up and so there are many countries that we cannot compete on low labors. The resulting of such model is that we have a very sensitive domestic purchasing power that way because we focus on export. We have high inequality. Most countries that are export oriented experience high inequality. This is already well established in the economic literature that most countries that focus on trade has high inequality because only big companies can export mostly, not SME. So if the economy is oriented towards outward, towards trade, international trade, inequality would likely rise. We are faced with middle income trap. Dr. Pravita already gave us definition of what middle income trap is. It's basically our income was not able to grow or increase, expand enough to become a high income country, so probably within 14 years that we're supposed to do. and we have an unhealthy environment because of exploitation of our natural resources to increase in, revenue, and also manufacturing, because we promote export, which is manufacturing based, is also very detrimental to our environment. So this is the result of our past development model. So this is a graph that is similar to that of Dr. Gurida, and you already saw that there is a huge discrepancy between the value added of each worker in the manufacturing, services, and agriculture. As you can see, agriculture is extremely low. It is surprising that we are an agriculture-based economy, but would you know that Thailand has one of the lowest rice productivity in ASEAN, lower than Vietnam and lower than the Philippines? How can that be? And this is because we use a lot of pesticides, and we do not have proper rice, the seedling. And of course, populist policy, such as the rice pledging scheme, has also been detrimental to our rice industry. Because of the rice pledging scheme, most rice growers do not care anymore about producing high quality rice. Because why do you bother? Because you get very good price if you just pledge the rice to the government and get very high price. And they're not picky about the quality of rice, they just want quantity. So that has put Thailand's rice industry several years backward because of their rice pledging scheme. But what is more interesting is that if you compare that, there is a big discrepancy between the manufacturing service productivity, and that gap between labor productivity in manufacturing and services is symptomatic of countries that are caught in the lower income. If you look at five countries, Singapore, Malaysia, Thailand, Philippines, and Indonesia, you can see that for countries with higher income countries, labor productivity in the service sector is actually higher than the manufacturing. As you can see, Singapore. Malaysia, there is still discrepancy, but less so than in Thailand, whereas Philippines and Indonesia, manufacturing is still very much higher than service. So countries that are not, the economic structure is not too well developed, there is still exists that gap between labor productivity in manufacturing and services. Okay, so what are the three scenarios of development that I would like to talk about? As I mentioned, we will draw three scenarios. One is do nothing. We continue on the same development path, which we call the base case. The second one is we head toward heavily industrialized economy. We want to be like Japan, we want to be like South Korea, with heavy manufacturing like steel, like petrochemicals, like automobiles. And then there's another third option, which is to promote modern agriculture and knowledge-based services. That means instead of going full steam into the manufacturing, we will turn into modern agriculture, because don't forget, Thailand is naturally an agriculture-based industry economy. We built our agricultural industry from ground. We did not import technology, unlike automobiles and unlike electronics, where we import foreign technology. But our agro industry is indigenous. Okay, so we're going to focus on our indigenous industry, which is agriculture, but we make it more modern, more higher value added. And again, this has been mentioned a lot, services. We cannot ignore services. And this message has been repeatedly confirmed by spirit speakers. Okay, so that's the third model. So we're going to see what's going to happen if we follow these three scenarios. Okay, let's start with the first scenario. If we continue on the way we have been, our GDP into the year 2045, we will grow about 3.55%, and this number is already mentioned before, that we're going to grow about this much. Okay, so okay, we're going to go 3.5% every year for the next 30 years. Our GDP person will going to go up to 17,000, which means we will become a high income country, which definition by the UN is $12,746. So we're going to reach that mark in the year 2036, another 20 years. So 10 years behind what Dr. Pavida said, 10 years after we've already become old. will become a high income country. So that will be a long time. If we follow this path, what's going to happen is that manufacturing GDP share will increase from 40 to 50. Services will remain almost the same, but agriculture will shrink from 10 to 5 or 4.4. Okay, our employee and labor force will be about 40%. Our Gini coefficient will be 0.37, which will be a little bit better, and GDP emission will be roughly the same. But to project these things will be nice and easy if everything is the way it has been or everything is the way we expect it to be. But don't forget, in real life, there are a lot of shocks and there are a lot of uncertainties. So we have to be prepared or try to prevent these kind of shocks and uncertainties that can certainly derail our development plans. What are Thailand's particularly risk? What are Thailand's shocks or type of risk? First is the climate change. We cannot ignore that climate change will have a major impact on the Thai economy. Already, as you will read in the news, we already have problem of drought. Water resource will be one of our major concerns, especially when we are agriculture-based country. But we don't seem to have a solution of how we're going to manage water resource more efficiently. In the past, if you ask why do we have a drought problem, it's because we were very afraid of getting a flood because we had bad memories of these heavy flood. So if you want to prevent flood, what do? You release all the water from the dam before the rainy season comes. But if you release all the water from the dams and there is no rain, what happened? Then you get drought. So this is what we get. We were so afraid of flood, we release all the water and now we don't have water. So managing flood and managing water resources, it's a very complex system. You need to be able to assess the type of risk. It's not that you're so afraid of flood and you just let all the water go and then you confront with drought. So Thailand has that big challenge of how do you manage water resource more efficiently. Our healthcare provision, fiscal burden will be also a big challenge. Aging society, we have a universal healthcare in Thailand. That will be a big ticket item. Populist policy will likely to remain in Thailand in our politics. So this is again another risk that we take into consideration. Currency crisis, banking crisis, and political crisis are the type of risk that can put Thailand backward. The numbers are the number of years that it will take for us to reach the high income. Okay, 2 years for climate change, 2 years for healthcare provision. Our political crisis is so large we cannot put number of years. So who knows? Could be 20 years, could be forever. So we put a question mark instead. The long-term prospects heavily, okay, so that is the, if we follow the way we are. The second option is, what if we want to take the way of South Korea and Japan? In that case, our GDP per capita will in 2045 will be 23,000, much higher than the initial scenarios, and our average growth will increase from 3.35 to 4.6, so a little bit higher growth. Economic structure will be manufacturing dominated by manufacturing. About 64% of our GDP will come from manufacturing. Again, agriculture will shrink to 3, services shrink to 1/3. We will become a high-income economy in 2028, much faster than the base case, 7 years faster. 3 years after we get old, we'll become rich, okay? Our Gini coefficient will deteriorate to 0.42. The others, the base case was 0.39. So our inequality will widen, and our GDP and CO2 emission will be much higher, because of manufacturing produce a lot of pollution. So this is the scenario if we want to take, but to go there are several do's and don'ts. Okay, it's not just that we're gonna get there. If we want to take this route, what does the government have to do? We can't expect the private sector just to take everything's in their own hands and go forward. The government has developed high quality infrastructure. We're talking about IT infrastructure, about transport infrastructure. The government will have to deliver these things. Has to create specialized engineers and technicians. This has already been discussed, that Thailand is lacking engineers and any technical lean production, R&D, especially in design and branding, and promote outward investment and marketing. These are very heavy, big tasks for the government to achieve. So it is not easy. If you want to follow the path of a heavy manufacturing, the government has to do all those. What the government has not should not do is to continue to rely on unskilled foreign workers. And this is the biggest problem in Thailand. On one hand, we said we want to upgrade, we want to become value added, but at the same time, the government is setting up the SEZ, the Special Economic Zone, along the Thai borders to allow the Thai industries to employ as much as foreign workers as they want along the borders. So how are you going to upgrade if you are facilitating access to unlimited supply of cheap labor from neighboring countries? So I really don't know what actually, there's so many things going on. But caution is that however we take this route, we can expect worsened income in distribution and worsened environment problems. The third model is that, okay, what if we want to go to the modern agriculture? We want to build on our home base, you know, our indigenous industry, which is agriculture, okay, and knowledge-based services. In that case, our GDP per capita will rise to 28. It will grow higher than the manufacturing model, which is 4-something percent. But in this model, economy can grow at higher rate, at 5.21. Basically because it engaged more people into the process. As Dr. Pavida and Dr. Girida has mentioned that manufacturing employs only 14% of the employment, but it generates a large revenue. But it employs only 14% of our workers. So if you go the manufacturing way, only a few percent of population workforce will be involved in the whole process. But if you employ services, which and hire a larger number of people, 30-40%, and agriculture, which hire 40% over, the combined of them hired 86% of our employment, then of course the whole population can gain and benefit from this development model rather than the manufacturing. So with that model, our income, we will reach the high income economy the same year as the other model. But there will be more employing in labor force, 74%, and our income distribution will be better with less environmental problem. But what do you mean by modern agriculture? You know what it means? It means that Thailand has to change the landscape of its agriculture. At the moment, if you look at Thai agriculture, it's very fragmented. We have very small scale rice farming. That's why low productivity, because it's so small. They're not like farms in the US when it's huge scale, you know, it's capital intensive, or in Brazil where farms are very large. But in Thailand, they're very small individual farms, and that's why we have very low productivity. So if we're gonna go this way, we really have to change. We have to have capital intensive, large scale farming. We have to employ precision farming technology, R&D, and we have to certify food safety. Because food quality is becoming a big issue for Thailand, the quality, because there are a lot of non-tariff barriers. And now it's not only the food quality, but also labor standards. As you know, Thailand is having a lot of problem with the IUU about illegal use of workers. So this is something the government has to charter. We can go to the choice of intensive farming, organic farming, becoming niche providers. So what are the do's and don'ts? I think if the government wants to go this way, they need to efficiently manage water resources mentioned already, promote quality standards, food safety, R&D in breeding, and magnified innovation, promote smart farmer, which means we can track down the source and manage factor cost of production, fertilizer, and pesticide. What the government must not do is to subsidize agricultural products at high price. That is, no more price pledging. We have a lot of price guarantee for many agricultural products, not only rice. Even today, we guarantee price for milk products, we guarantee price for tapioca, we right? So many products, and this promote inefficient production because we don't limit the amount of agricultural products that we will guarantee, unlimited. So everybody is selling to the government. We need to promote large-scale agriculture, and contract farming will become a social, hot social issue. You know, this because there's already tension between big companies and farmers under contract farming, but we can talk about that later because I have limited time. So what about the service? At the same time, we can promote services, but as mentioned, it's not massage or anything. We need to focus on high skill, which is finance, ICT, business service, or we can focus on social services, such as medical treatment. Thailand is already a medical hub. We can build on that. Education, I think we have changed a lot in terms of international school. Before we have a few, now it's coming mushrooms and public provisions. At the same time, we can build on our traditional service, which is tourism related. If we go this way, what are the do's and don'ts? Do's, we need a lot of skilled labor to facilitate this kind of, to support this kind of services. We need to open up for foreign skilled workers and professionals. Most of you know here how difficult it is to work as a professional in this country. You know, we have very restrictive labor laws. We have to improve ICT infrastructure. Most importantly, we need to liberalize service sector. Thailand has the most restricted foreign investment regime for services. We do not allow foreign equity share above 49% for any service. Every single service is under the Foreign Business Act. You need R&D. What Thailand needs to do if it wants to go the service way, it has to stop protect market power for domestic service businesses. Our service industry is highly protected. One is because of limitation of foreign investment. But don't forget, we also have a lot of state-owned enterprises playing a big role in the big services, and these have monopoly powers. You don't need to look far. There are PTT, the energy, the huge, humongous energy, or the electricity generation. So these are still government monopolies and transport. So we need to do away with those. But then again, there are certain caution. Inequality depends on ratio of each type of service and education investment. Large financial sectors may increase risk of financial crisis. So liberalization has to be balanced with stability. If we promote medical hub, we can obstruct access to service by domestic patients. There is a big controversial issue on whether Thailand should become a medical hub, because medical hub is sucking in all the resources, medical resources from the regional and the rural areas. So finally, so where do we go from here? Our final conclusion is that moving towards service economy, it certainly will provide a more pleasant environment. But Thailand has high share of manufacturing sector, and this is exactly what Dr. Pravida said, that we can't just all go services because we have a huge manufacturing base. So what do we do? I think the way forward is not one or the other. I think we still need to keep manufacturing sector, but we need to upscale the skills of the Thai workers, but at the same time, we have also provide service sector as well. And we believe that the best bridge between manufacturing and service is the modern agriculture and knowledge-based services, because agriculture is also manufacturing, because we have an agriculture-based. So we really can build on agro-industry, and we can add more value to agricultural services. So this is probably the way we can go forward. Thank you.